Dr. István Jánosi from Research Institute for Solid State Physics and Optics from Budapest, and he will be talking about non-linear optical properties of azotized dopant-rigid crystals. Please.
Now, liquid crystal which contains azot dyes, or it is made up from azot dyes itself, then what is the effect of cis trans-cis isomerization? Now cis isomers, isomers as they have a V shape, they are like impurities. The trans state is compatible with liquid crystalline order, which is composed of fluid-like molecules, but the cis is more like a sphere. So it acts like impurity, and so the photo, if we create by light cis isomers, this will decrease all the parameter of the liquid crystal, and this is particularly strong effect when the liquid crystal is composed itself of azo compounds. And this effect is many respect analogous to the decrease of the temperature, because decrease of the temperature also decrease the order. And this leads to photoimage space transitions, which were studied by Tomiki Ikeda in Japan and from Russell in Macau. Okay, now nonlinear absorption is due to the fact that the trans and cis component have different absorption spectra. And for this reason, we can write, if we have a mixture with azot dyes in it, then we can write the absorption spectra as a linear superposition of absorption due to the cis forms and absorption due to the trans form, and X is the cis concentration. And we can describe the dependence on light intensity of the concentration by this simple formula, which is maybe a phenomenological form. And if we have a light beam, then it is exponentially attenuated. But now as intensity decreases within the layer, the absorption coefficient, the cis concentration will also change, and then the absorption coefficient will also change. So we have to put here the integral. And so the attenuation will be non-exponential, and its output intensity will the ratio of the input and output, the transmission coefficient, will depend on the input intensity. So this is a simple problem which can be analytically solved, and here you see some measurements. This is the nonlinear transmission over linear transmission versus the input power. And if there were no isomerization, then we would have this line at one. It wouldn't depend on the input power. But here we have actual measurements, and it's very well this theoretical curve which is given by this formula, which can be deducted from the previous equation. Now if we can also have a microscopic model for the saturation intensity and the saturation concentration and saturation intensity, and this involves the quantum efficiency of trans-cis and cis-trans transition, and also the absorption cross-section orientationally averaged quantities. And in the liquid crystal, this orientational average, it depends on what is the polarization of the light beam with respect to the director. And this led to the following effect, that the control of cell transmission can be controlled by the polarization of the palm beam. So here we see a pump probe experiment, and here we have, and I showed the pump, the probe transmission in arbitrary units, and here is with this low pump, and here we have with this ordinary polarized pump, the transmission, and then we see that it's a much bigger, 2.5 times with extraordinary pump. And then also the saturation intensity depends on the polarization. Okay, now I turn to the second big topic of this talk. This is optical reorientation in azodiode liquid crystals. Now we heard from Oleg very briefly about optical reorientation. It's in essence, you can reorient liquid crystals with electric and magnetic field, but you can also reorient it with a light beam due to the electric field vector of the light. And as Oleg mentioned, the first person to observe this was Zalpay in 1970. But then this work wasn't continued, but it was taken up in the 80s, and then there was a lot of work on optical reorientation in transparent liquid crystals. But now in the 90s, it was observed that this optical reorientation is greatly enhanced when we put dye into the liquid crystal, and this was observed by a number of groups. And the phenomenological description of this mechanism is that we have this term which is the dielectric mechanism, which is valid in transparent mechanism, but we have an enhancement factor which is due to the dye. And dye is very and the enhancement factor is very dye specific, and it's interesting thing is that it can be both positive, so in that case we have the normal reorientation when the director turns towards the electric field vector of the light beam, but it can be also in most cases it's negative, so we have an inverse effect. Director is oriented perpendicular to the electric field. And this was observed, this effect was with antrachinon dye, and it is an example of a positive enhancement. Here is also antrachinon dye, but with different substitutes, and this is an example of negative enhancement. And this enhancement can be quite substantial. Normally it's a dimensionless factor. It's about can be at 1% of dye, it can be several hundred. Now, what is about optical orientation in Azotai thermodynamics? This was first studied by Zolotko in Moscow, and he observed an anomalous angular dependence of the ground-induced torque. This was with this Bisazodai. I don't know why he took a Bisazodai, but it was not exactly this, but something very similar. And he observed that when the wave vector is parallel to the directors and self-refocusing occurs, which corresponds to a negative enhancement. But when he changed the angle from normal tropic center from normal to tilted, then above a certain critical angle, the wave vector then it became positive, the enhancement. And now, how can we? Okay, and this was afterwards found in many pieces of dyes and metals as a dyes. I think in all as a dyes which were studied, this effect was found. So how can we interpret this? Now, it's the same as we generalize the absorption coefficient in for the absorption coefficient in a mixture which contains cis and trans isomers, we can also generalize the enhancement factor in this way. So I assume that the cis and conformers give independent contribution to the enhancement effect of optical torque. And now, as we saw, the cis concentration depends on the intensity and the polarization direction of the optical field. And now let us first investigate the high intensities and where we have an intensity much bigger than the saturation intensity, and here's the cis concentration is about the saturation intensity. And now if we take this wave equations and so on, then we can find out that how the saturation intensity depends on the angle between the polarization and the director. Because as I told you, the x depends on this angle. And then here is a typical curve. And the extraordinary, and this means with extraordinary light, this concentration, and then this is with the ordinary light. Right. And now, if we look at the observation at homeotropic alignment, we have this. This relation just from the linear superposition, and this is fine experimentally, that is defocusing, so it must be smaller than zero. And at planar alignment we have this extraordinary, which was found that we have around zero. It is bigger than zero, so it's self-focusing effect, and this is only possible if we assume that the trans amplification factor, trans enhancement factor is negative, and the cis one is positive. So this is an interesting thing that that they have different signs of transiencies, amplification. here is a measurement of the amplification factor as in the function of the degree, of course it's 90 degrees, so this is homeotropic, and since these points were taken in the homeotropic cell, these were taken in the planar cell, and here is a gap between, because with a plant parallel cell, we cannot get arbitrary incidence, but we see very well that really the enhancement factors change sign. And from this curve, we can even deduce the transverses, which are huge if we consider that it is only 0.3% of this line in a liquid crystal mixture. But these are huge, but the overall effect is much less because the transverses tend to compensate each other. And another way to show this, that at low intensities, we have this concentration changes with intensity, and if we choose properly the geometry, then we find that as a function of the intensity, so these are taken with very low intensities for degree orientation, and here we see the new space shift, and here we have a mainly transconformers, and then after time as the cisconformers appears, and it compensates the effect of the trans, and then it even overcomes it and it becomes positive. So this is a the sign of nonlinearity changes sign with the input intensity. And this is that are corrected for sound effects, so this is not the pure, this is not the real experimental data. So this shows in another way that we really have. Okay. Now, as concluding this talk, I want to speak a little bit about effects induced by polarized light in azobrided polymers. And I will mention two effects, light-induced optical anisotropy, which is also sometimes called Weigert effect, and light-induced anisotropic surface relief. So the Weigert effect is observed in a number of condensed matter. First it was observed by Weigert in 1919 in color photoarmor emulsion, and this is why there is a called Weigert effect. And after it was found in silver, light crystals, chalcogenide glasses, high viscosity liquids, and also in azobrided polymers, which is a very famous word by Todorov from Bulgaria. And this effect is a consequence of orientationally selective excitation and the restricted mobility of the dye, because in liquid crystal, I didn't tell you, but we always assume that the diffusion of the rotational diffusion of the molecules are very, very fast, and so we can always assume instantaneous order of thermodynamically established order of the Moser transmembrane. But in these systems, there's a restricted mobility, so once it's reoriented by the light, trans, due to a trans cis trans isomerization process. Then the until the next excitation comes, it retains its orientation, and this is a basic patterns of photoalignment of liquid crystals on azotide polymers, which was a subject of and will be a subject of many talks. Now, maybe a less known thing is a polarized beam induced anisotropic surface heavy, and the emphasis of these are anisotropic surface heavy. And I took this picture, which I will show from Applied Physics Letters. It's a group at MIT, which was led by Tripathi. And the sample this was a very simple setup, just a polarized laser beam on a sample, which was a azobenzene functionalized epoxy-based polymer layer. And then it's important that the gas transition temperature was above 100 degrees, and the experiment was performed at room temperature. And this is taken from this paper. And here you see the surface heavy by AFM. And this is interesting that it is anisotropic in orientation, and then these hills, these peaks correspond, they are in the direction of the light polarization, and with circularly polarized light you get something like a crater. And this is with cylindrical lens. And here you also see, this is when the polarization is along the x direction, this is the x direction, and when it is polarized to in y direction, then there is no effect or very small effect. And the suggested interpretation is it's evident that material transport is involved, and this is somehow due to the light field. And Tripathi's group suggested that the ponderomotoric force, that's the same name, I guess, as the gradient force, which we heard about a lot in the laser tracer experiment. So this causes the material flow. But it occurs only in azotide polymers. And so the question is that what is the role of azotides? And Tripathi's group suggested that it is photoplastization, because the experiment was carried out well below the glass transition temperature, so it is assumed that it becomes softer, the material, due to this trans-cis isomerization and this trans-cis-trans cycles. And this idea was developed quite recently by Young. But I have my doubts about this interpretation. And now I want to finish by saying that I tried an alternative explanation, which is this connected to the Weigert effect. The Weigert effect causes an isotropic distribution of the trans molecules, but this will cause also an isotropic stress tensor. And this is just as long as a gradient into the different illumination, then this will give a bigger force, and this force somehow enhances the ponderimetric force, just like in the case of liquid crystals, the interaction with the light enhances the rotation of the torque, so this will enhance the force, the ponderimetric force. But I must admit that this explanation which I suggest cannot explain everything. Okay, Rogoff can explain about half of the observation, but the other half still remains, in my opinion, an open question, because I don't believe this this is correct, this explanation. So it is an open question. Okay, so conclusions. Okay, so as a dipole system can exhibit a number of interesting light-induced effect, and this allows a change of all the parameters, nonlinear absorption, change of sign, preorientation of nonlinearity with angle of incidence of intensity, then polymers, light-induced panel, and biofringes, and finally I mentioned the problem of light-induced surface beliefs. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Janosi, for the nice lecture, and I will take the questions here. Yes, please.
I think that in case of UV, it is a well-established technique to create crosslinks or to break chains, and then by this they can create anisotropic polymers, and then this is the well-known method to produce planar cells. That is a commercial method to use photo orientation. But I don't think that heating plays a role.
You have two other groups.
Yes.
This component you irradiate, you can produce.
Yeah.
You have press.
Yes. But there is one. Okay, from decay experiments we saw in first approximation only one exponential, but if we look closer on the curves, and then one can see a second a much slower exponential decay also. So that is a problem, yes. So it's a simplification to speak about transverse isomerization in Pisa supplies, but this was taken only because not of course, I don't know for what reason. Or I know that for what reason he took the Pisa supplies.
Why the light absorption depend on the intensity of the
illumination time? On the illumination?
Yeah, intensity of absorption.
It's just there's an attenuation within the cell, and the entrance space, you have a lot of seats, but then it attenuates the beam and that's a level of
stimulation. But my question is, since you are treating the absorption of azo dye depends on the enhanced light, not the attenuation light.
On the input intensity. Yeah, it depends on the input intensity. Yeah, because because when you have a high intensity, then already at the whole sample becomes cis. Okay, almost the saturation cis. But when you have low intensity, then it's mainly trans. So that at this low intensity you have the trans coefficient, and at high intensity you have the transmission coefficient.
Just the change of ratio of the two species.
Yes.
So we have one more question for Harry, and then we will set up the other one.
It's kind of a comment and a question. Most of these experiments are carried out with laser beams. And most of the profiles of those laser beams are Gaussian. So you will always get in the center of the beam a higher intensity. Therefore you'll either get a higher temperature, and we used to do laser writing 29 years ago like this, or you get a higher density of cis isomers, which again leads to a density change, and you must get a fluid event.
Yeah, but okay, we work with since cells, but we observe that the bigger signals, there are really some anomalies which I think is due to flow effects.
All right, we will allow one more question, and then we will move.
So in this, I'd just like to sort of continue the question that was asked, the first question. So, you know, about temperature. I mean in the surface relief profiles.
Yes.
I mean, it looks like there are thermal effects possible.
Because it depends on the polarization, this surface. So it cannot be, because if you change the polarization, the thermal effect should be the same. And it seems to be dependence on the polarization direction. For instance, with the cylindrical lens.
But if you're illuminating, any of these azo systems, let's just say you're illuminating them with unpolarized light.
Yeah.
Okay, then you're photo-inducing a cis-trans isomerization.
Yes.
So if you watch the azo molecules, they're jumping around. Much more aggressively than they would be in the dark.
Yeah.
So I think you can assign a temperature to that.
But these were carried out, on the other hand, these were carried out with very, very low intensity. I don't think that's thermal effects.
I think if you can actually measure that temperature, it's, you know, it can be 500 or 600 Kelvin.
No.
Yeah, I think so.
I don't know. Okay, this is not my experiment, so I don't know.
Well, I mean, just in general, these azo systems, I think.
I know. Because even in the liquid crystal experiments, we get, 2-3 degrees of temperature.
Well, ultimately, that's what, ends up in the bulk system, but I mean, if you watch the individual molecules, they're much more, you know, adaptive than the other ones.
Okay, you can define a molecular temperature or something like that.
Yeah.
Okay, but I don't think that it is an overall temperature crisis. Is this okay?
Well, I know it's an interesting topic and we have a lot of questions, but we will continue with the coffee break, I guess, and we will move to other speaker. So, our next talk will be non-linear optical properties of azole diodo crystals. No, sorry. Sorry, the first one. Okay, so we are continuing with azo dyes, but we go to azo bridged ferroelectric liquid crystals. And so our next speaker is from the Display Tech. It's Yongchang Zhang, and so he will tell us about his work.